My name is Dr. Jonathan Tarbox, and I'm the Director of Research and Development here at the Center for Autism and Related Disorders. Today I have the treat of sitting in for Shannon Penrod on Autism Live to host her Ask Dr. Doreen show today. So we have here Dr. Doreen Grampuche, the founder and director of the Center for Autism and Related Disorders. And we're going to take an hour to answer questions from our viewers and our listeners. A special treat here to get advice from one of the top autism research and treatment experts in the world. So with that, maybe we'll just get right into it.
Sounds great. Nice to be here, getting excited to start.
All right. Let's take a look here. So the first question we have from our viewers is, and I'm just kind of reading verbatim here, since my son was two, his eating is his number one challenge. I have begged for 8 years for help, so where can I go to get help?
Okay, so before we start answering the questions, I just want to make sure that our audience knows that I'm going to do my best to answer these in a pretty general format because we don't really want to be giving individual advice for children. Everything please take with caution because it might not apply to your child. So I'm going to try to watch that. So the question has to do with eating, I guess. And the family said this child has had problems since the age of two.
And it sounds like the child is about 10 now.
Okay.
And has had problems with eating since two. It's still his number one challenge and they're getting no help.
Okay. And this is a really good subject, actually. I'm real happy you're here, Jonathan, because this is something you and I have talked about a lot. Mm-hmm. So I think what happens with feeding disorders, or within our kids anyway, is that they begin, generally, in my opinion, they begin with something that has more of a biological cause, and then they generalize and become learned behavior. So I kind of want to talk a little bit about that. For this family, it would be important to take a look at the child's biochemistry and just make sure that the child is not low on particular nutrients. Since it is like 8 years ago, I'm not sure what would have started the process for this child. But regardless, as I always say on this show, it's really important to make sure that your child is stable, healthy, eating all the things they're supposed to be so that they're receiving nutrition from their foods. And then if you are able to make sure that your child is nutritionally stable, then we can deal with this issue from a behavioral perspective, and it's actually quite an easy process. So the way that we do it, just in summary, and you can comment on this
sure.
as well. The process with behavioral intervention for feeding problems is you generally start with what does the child actually eat. And you look at those items and you want to make sure you select the ones that are okay and you want to keep those things in the child's menu, let's say, or diet going forward. And then you list the types of foods that the child is not willing to eat. And you start with a very, tiny portion of the item that the child is not willing to try. And you see if you can reward the child for taking a tiny morsel of that. And then gradually you increase the food. I mean, that's a very simplistic way of saying it, because a lot of times the child won't even be willing to taste the item. And so you will, in general, in feeding, you'll start with the smallest amount, but also something that doesn't necessarily require chewing. And so you're increasing the amount as well as you're increasing the texture, you're increasing the what the requirements are. So like initially you'll want something that can just immediately be swallowed. Later you will also work on chewing and get the child up to that level. So even though I'm kind of describing it in a very easy, non-technical way. It's a process. It's one of the well-known and established procedures in ABA, and it's possible to many of our feeding kids, actually, when they start. We've even had children who were on G-tubes,
That's right.
They weren't really even eating anything, and it's very possible to get them very gradually to a process where they're able to eat a healthy diet or a healthy menu, all meals.
In fact, you know, our own Dr. Adele Nadalski here has published a couple studies on exactly the procedure you're describing,
right,
where, you know, these kids were eating nothing but, you know, chicken McNuggets and French fries,
right,
at intake, and by requiring the smallest bite of broccoli and then the kid gets a whole plate of French fries,
that's
step one.
That's right.
Step 50 in the end is the kid's eating a totally nutritionally appropriate, well-rounded meal and, you know, has better nutrition than most typical kids.
Absolutely.
So it's absolutely possible.
And you know, I'm glad you brought that up, because most of the times when parents come to us, they have kids who are eating a lot of specific carbohydrates, like breaded nuggets or just, let's say, types of bread or types of pasta. And also we have kids who are drinking mass quantities of milk and they refuse to eat anything else. We also have kids who won't eat anything unless it has a specific look or
texture.
Right,
yeah.
Or like perfect round Cheerios or, you know, just things that are crunchy. Those things, you know, for sure are learned behavior. Even when you look at us adults, typically developing adults, you know, you might go out and eat something and it'll disturb you. Like, let's say you have Mexican food and it might bother you that day. We tend to even generalize, but we generalize in a different way because we know more about foods. We'll stop eating anything, let's say, that has the same consistency, like beans or a variety of things. Like, you know, you might have black beans causing you problems, but then you'll also end up staying away from garbanzo beans. That's how adults generalize.
Right.
With our kids, they don't understand that these are the same food groups, so they'll generalize based on color, look, you know, I won't eat anything that looks like this or mm-hmm. smells like this, those types of things. And so they become very, very picky eaters.
Or even brand specific. We've had some kids
Absolutely.
That will only eat French fries, but they have to be in the McDonald's cup.
That's right.
So you can't even, you know,
right.
go somewhere else, Burger King, and get French
fries. That's right. And so, especially with the diets that have shown some effect for our kids, it's important to really look at, you know, do I want my child eating a lot of carbohydrates? And that's kind of why I started with, you really need to start with a nutritionist to identify the things you want in your child's diet. And then a behaviorist can easily do this type of program, no question.
Yeah, and you know, really consistently, all of the ABA feeding research has shown that it's possible to get children on the spectrum and other children off the spectrum who have feeding disorders to eat a wide variety of foods, fruits, vegetables, proteins, starches. There's no reason why a kid has to be eating only, you know, McDonald's French fries.
That's
or
right.
only carbs. So
that's right.
It's very
So
doable.
I'm you know, surprised, disappointed that this family hasn't been able to get help in such a long time, because
it's
actually easier when the child's younger.
Yeah.
But nevertheless, even at age 10, it doesn't really matter any age, you can definitely do these interventions.
That's right.
Yeah, great.
All right, let's take a look at the next one. It's related. My son will only eat mashed food. So my wife wants to work on getting him to eat more textures.
There you go.
But I would rather work on speech. So which one of us is right?
This
show is not about marriage counseling, but...
Hey, I love those questions. You know, and that is such an important question, because a lot of times we run out of time and have to, you know, make things a priority. So the feeding process, if your child's eating mashed foods, I think that it's not too complex or complicated, or it won't take too long to get to the point where you're eating textured foods. It's a gradual process. I mean, I don't know your child again, but I wouldn't think that it would take more than a month, perhaps, to get your child to that point. And at any given time, I would hope that you're doing more than just a couple of hours a day, or maybe an hour a day you'd be focusing on the feeding program, and the rest of the time you would definitely be focusing on other deficits or areas that you need to work on. So, you know, if it was me, I'd probably say, and depends on the age of your child as well. I'd probably say the most important thing for me is to get my children communicating. Right. So I would really emphasize you do need to get language into your child's program, whether it's verbal, vocal, or non-vocal. Some form of communication is very, very important because kids tend to get frustrated if they can't communicate.
Of course.
And having said that, though, you know, I've also seen cases where the child has become so picky that it's impossible to go anywhere with the child. The child's really not receiving nutrition at all because they won't eat a variety of things. So those are both important issues, and hopefully you would be able to address both. You know, a lot of times with our older kids, we also run out of time. We have a mass array of things we want to work on. Mm-hmm. Yet we know the child is school age. We also have to now start including academics. It becomes really difficult. Mm-hmm. But, you know, that's something the two of you should discuss, and the best solution, add some hours and deal with both.
That's right. And, you know, it's worth mentioning, too, that there are at least some really good quality BCBAs that know how to work on both. It's where it doesn't need to be a
Absolutely.
Choice. So if, you know, if you're getting an hour or two of therapy from a top quality clinician, they should be able to address both language and communication as well
right.
as eating.
Right.
As well as training you as a caregiver to address those things when they're not present. So
that's right.
It shouldn't have to be a choice.
And then I think the other thing to think about is that sometimes our kids are the feeding issues, especially in this case where you have a child who's taking mashed foods but not chewing or not taking textured foods, could also just be related to, or you know, somewhat related to apraxia. So your child's tongue muscles are not moving the way they should, and that could also be part of the reason your child is not producing language. So the activities involved in chewing might actually help the child produce
That's right.
language as well.
Absolutely.
So it's kind of a good thing to try to work on both.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, in fact, it's likely that the two things could complement
could
one
correlate,
another.
Yeah.
All right, let's take a look at the next question here. I'm so confused. They say my son is high functioning, but he can't be considered Asperger's because he has a speech delay, but he is real smart, but he does have a lot of autistic traits. So he's been seen by 4 psychologists, so what should I do next? So it sounds like they're saying he has high functioning autism maybe, but doesn't qualify for Asperger's because he has a speech delay. 4 psychologists can't agree. What do we do next?
Okay, so if you have speech delay and you're pretty high functioning and you're not qualifying for Asperger's, possibly your child might qualify for a diagnosis of PDD-NOS, pervasive developmental disorder not otherwise specified. And we've hit on this a few times in the past, and I'll just quickly review it. The difference with the 3 main diagnoses, when you're looking at a diagnosis of autism, you basically have 6 symptoms that you're looking for, and they're, you know, in the areas of social behavior, in the areas of communication, and then the presence of what we call stereotypic repetitive behaviors or self-stimulatory behaviors. And when you have 6 symptoms, then it becomes a diagnosis of autism. And when you have less than 6, so let's say 5 symptoms, then you're looking at a diagnosis of PDD-NOS, or pervasive developmental disorder. So it's just a sort of a higher functioning version of the same thing. It does include speech delay. With Asperger's, you are looking at similar symptoms, so there's definitely a social delay, and oftentimes there's also the presence of those stereotypic repetitive behaviors, just a different version, just sort of a higher level of them. So, the child, you know, an Asperger's child will not necessarily be lining up objects, but they will be very obsessive about things being in proper order. So it's sort of the same thing, but just a little more, you know, higher level or mature version of repetitive behaviors. So, and then in the diagnosis of Asperger's, you don't really have a speech delay. It's not one of the required symptoms. However, I will say that pretty much all of our kids with Asperger's have a social language delay.
Right.
So I don't know if, in the case of this child, if we're looking at, if the parent is saying, my child has speech delay versus an advanced sort of social language delay.
Because right, inability to use speech
exactly.
successfully socially.
Yeah, socially, and or understand advanced speech, you know, or abstract
right.
speech.
Right. So perspective taking these
exactly.
kinds of
a lot of our Asperger's kids are completely fine. You can't tell with their social, with their initial language. Ability, but once you start getting into conversation with them, then you realize that, oh, they really don't understand very advanced social, like inferring information from someone's language or those types of things, which really does, as you mentioned, go back to the theory of mind deficit. So, but if your child is very high functioning and has some basic speech delays meaning, you know, the basic formation of language, or the child is like lacking in some aspect of their basic formation. So, you know, their sentences are incorrect, or they're missing a series of words, or they don't use adjectives, descriptors, past tense, future. Those are all speech issues. Those types of things, then you're most likely looking at a diagnosis of PDD-NOS. And really, having said that, who cares? I mean, quite honestly, the diagnosis shouldn't necessarily matter all that much, because the treatment is the same in
right.
my mind. You know, when you look at a child with autism, you're going to be doing a lot of behavioral intervention, but hey, with a lot of our PDD children, we do a lot of intervention as well, because the goal is to identify the child's specific delays, and not just as simple as, you know, speech delay, but very, very detailed figuring out, you know, what areas of speech, what areas of language is my child delayed in, in contrast to his own age, and then teaching those. And so if your child has fewer of those deficits, great, you still need
to
teach the areas, right? And if your child has more, then you need a little bit more of an intensive program. And if your child is more Asperger's, where the the delays are more in sort of abstract language concepts, then you're looking at using the behavioral intervention techniques, but we kind of move away from basic discrete trial modality, and we're moving more into a cognitive behavioral mode of intervention. It's all still follows the same principles of ABA. So I think that's what's critical for this family. Don't get too hung up on the diagnosis. I don't know why four professionals wouldn't be able to identify this. I'm not sure what other issues there were.
I see that a lot.
Yeah, it does happen quite a bit. Absolutely. You need to find someone who has some experience in this field, I think.
Yeah.
But more importantly, you know, our skills program, which is on online, will help you establish an exact detailed list of all the different areas that of deficit that your child might have.
Right. And that rather than worrying about diagnosis,
exactly.
it just helps you identify what exact skills will my child benefit from learning, and then
That's
it
right.
gives you tools to help you teach.
That's
them.
Right. A lot of parents, when they come to me, they will ask, you know, how do I even know what I should teach? Like, and that's, I think, the most important thing, because you don't just take the child and say, oh, okay, I'm going to start with a traditional ABA program and we're going to teach the child matching and sorting and
right.
labels and this and that. And that might not apply to your child at all, which is why on our skills program, we start with an assessment. You have to assess, and I don't mean a functional behavior assessment, because that's looking at challenging behaviors, and I don't mean standardized assessments, because they're too broad, you know, like IQ tests or language testing and so on, they're very broad. I mean a very specific item by item, can your child do this, can your child do this, can your child say this, and so on. And that helps us establish a really good baseline of your child's needs. And I don't know if there are other questionnaires out there like skills, the assessment on skills, but I think it's important to start with a really detailed assessment of exactly your child's skills and deficits.
That's right. And, you know, it's always been considered part of the gold standard ABA approach is to conduct a very detailed assessment.
Correct.
It's just that there historically have not been very many tools out there to do it. So everyone kind of reinvents the wheel and just kind of does, you know, follows their gut.
That's right.
And, you know, you can do the direct observation, you can test out individual skills, but where do you go to actually identify which particular skills to test? So that's why I think that's one of the main contributions of the assessment in the skills system.
That's right.
It's comprehensive.
And it's also one of the reasons that we can't seem to, you know, I think we started out with something like 4,000 questions, and our assessment on skills really just goes up to mental age 8, not chronological age, but mental age 8. And we found, oh my gosh, it's very overwhelming for a parent to answer 4,000 questions if they have an 8-year-old. But the truth is, we're looking at assessing across so many different areas of functioning, not just language, but, you know, everything from social skills and cognitive skills and adaptive and academic and motor and all areas of functioning. And I think with the help of technology and intelligent software, mm-hmm. we've been able to kind of cut this down to, I think, 1,700 questions or something. And I wish that
less if you're younger.
And much less, yeah, if you're 2 or 3, obviously you only answer questions that are age appropriate.
Right.
But, you know, we struggle with this, and we try to reduce the number of questions we're asking parents. But again, it's so important to have that detail, because you could easily have a child who has skills in very specific areas and holes within those skills. And unless you teach those little tiny holes of deficits, you won't be able to move forward. You know, if I never know that my child doesn't understand, let's say, possessive pronouns, but he's fine with personal pronouns, so I might think, oh, he understands pronouns.
Right, yeah.
Then moving forward,
it
just makes it more confusing for the child if you haven't really done a clean job of teaching all the basic skills.
That's right.
So, yeah.
All right, with that, we're going to move to a brief break, but stay with us. We have lots more questions to ask Dr. Doreen. Hi, welcome back to Autism Live, the Ask Dr. Doreen show. My name is Dr. Jonathan Tarbox, and I'm sitting in for Shannon Penrod. So we will just continue here with more questions from our viewers.
Sounds good.
So this question is for Dr. Doreen. Why do kids on the spectrum bite? I teach second grade, and over the years I have had kids in my classroom with autism, and all of them have had issues with biting. Is this just part of the deal?
That's a great question. I love it. And I love that we have a teacher who's emailing us. Thank you for that.
I was thinking that too.
Yeah, that's really nice. Okay, so we've also talked about this in the past on other segments of the show. You know, all behaviors, from a behavioral perspective, if you're talking about biting, hitting, pinching, it doesn't matter, there's a huge array, are a form of communication. So whenever you have a behavior, say biting, you have to ask yourself, why is the child biting? What's the function of this behavior? And generally speaking, it's going to narrow down. It's going to be either he's trying to get away from some situation, or he's trying to gain access to something he wants. And generally, if it happens in school, in the classroom, I'm assuming that he's biting other children, or he might be biting the teacher or aide. And, you know, just some possible functions could be he bites another child if he wants an object the other child is holding onto. He might bite the aide or the teacher because they place a demand. You place a demand, and he doesn't really want to do what you're asking him. So, you know, one of the things that Jonathan here taught me years ago was this, the best way to look at it is, you know, what is he trying to gain access to or avoid? And that's really the bottom line when you look at it. And you know, it's a coincidence that you have children back to back who are all biters, but they've chosen that as a modality to communicate their needs. So, that's fine because they've realized, you know, okay, biting seems to be the one thing that works.
Yeah, when you think about it, it's very effective.
It's very effective.
No one's going to ignore biting.
That's right.
It's going to have an effect.
That's right. I mean, and a lot of times the easy way to look at it is to say, if he had language, what would he say?
Yeah.
And a lot of times, if you think about it, if the child had language, they'd probably say, I want that toy. And a lot of times our kids don't have the ability yet to understand things like sharing. You know, this is my toy, I want to play with it, you get to play with it in an hour time, you know, we can all play with it together at recess, playing. They don't have those concepts in their understanding. So they see something they want it, and they want it now. And if they can't have it now, then they will think, okay, what do I do? Maybe I'll push the child. Okay, that didn't work. Maybe I'll pinch the child. That didn't work. I'm going to grab it. Oh, it looks like the best way for me to get what I want is to bite the child, and bite the child will start crying, go to the teacher. I get my object. So it's just become a very effective way of communicating, and that's really all it is. And of course, in terms of behavioral intervention, you prevent that behavior from happening, so you block it and you replace it. And ideally, and that's one of the reasons a few minutes ago we were saying communication early, development of communication is so important, because if you don't teach a child to communicate appropriately, they will transfer over to these challenging behaviors, because that's the only way they can communicate. So with this child, what would help, or with any of the children, it would be very important to teach them a different way to communicate the same thing. And so, assuming, just as the example was, I want to have that toy, you would, if it's a verbal child or vocal child, then you would teach the child to vocalize the name of the toy, or just toy, and perhaps you would have a backup toy that you could give that child as a reward when they vocalize. And the same, at the same time, you don't allow the biting, which means you will need an assistant so that the child's not able to get away with the biting. And if it's a non-vocal child, you can easily have a picture system available for the child, so they can touch an icon, for instance, to express their need.
Or hand over a picture card. Or
hand
sign
over
language,
a picture,
anything.
Exactly.
As
or
long
any,
as low
any
effort.
Kind of, some, exactly. That's the effort involved in the new behavior should be less than the effort involved in biting someone. And then the reward should only be given when the child exhibits the new behavior, not when they bite. So if they do bite a child, you want to make sure they're not receiving the object or toy. And the same goes for if the child's biting the teacher, you, for instance. It's the same thing. You prevent them having access to the thing or the situation they're seeking if they bite, but you allow them to have access if they communicate their desire in a more appropriate way. And that's just, a very basic thing. So it's not really that biting goes hand in hand with autism. Not at all. Jonathan made a list, part of the skills program is this section called the BIP Builder. And we, in order to produce this program, you had to develop a list of all the different, what we call, topographies of behavior. And really, if a child is trying to communicate something and it's through a challenging behavior, the list can go on and on. It doesn't have to be biting.
Maybe 80-something behaviors on the list by now.
There you go.
And as soon as we think we're done, a user emails us in, hey, add this to the list.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, there's a million different ways that we can aggress, let's say, towards other people. And keep in mind, it is often more effective.
Absolutely, it's more effective, especially in the classroom, because quite frankly, teachers are busy. You have 20 or 30 other children to deal with. You can't necessarily spend all of your time with this one particular child.
Right.
And so, honestly, let's just all be honest, and it's the same thing with us at home as parents. We can't give every child the attention that we wish we could necessarily.
Right.
We're paying bills, we're doing the dishes, whatever we're doing. So same thing in the classroom. If the child bites, they're going to have a bigger effect on their environment than if they don't bite. And
that's
why we as teachers need to really stack the deck in favor of good behavior. So man, if you do the good behavior, if you communicate, you get this huge amount of what you want, versus if you bite, you're not going to get what you want at all.
That's exactly right. And I'm glad you explained it that way, because one of the other things for this teacher to think about is it might not even be a tangible object. It might,
right.
The child might just want attention.
Mm-hmm.
And just think about it. If you're attending to 20, 30 children overall, what's the best way to get your attention is
hurt
for a child to hurt someone else, and then they'll, you'll have to intervene.
That's right.
And that's one of the reasons that we you know, I feel like when the children have those types of behaviors, you really do need more support as a teacher. I mean, it is truly, I would say, impossible. Even, you know, you take the best behaviorist and you give them a classroom of 20 children, and if you have children in there who are physically aggressing towards other kids, it's not going to be possible for the teacher to intervene appropriately every time, because you have to deal with the other children, and that's important.
And without sufficient support and without good behavior intervention plans in place, what we inevitably see is a turn towards drugs, right? And so,
that's right.
You know, the adults realize medication. We can't handle this, what are we going to do? And the kid ends up getting overly medicated
in
order to prevent challenging behavior, when the real solution is teach communication, give the kid what he wants when he communicates, and not when he's engaging in challenging
behavior. That's right. That's exactly right. And, you know, I mean, we're kind of simplifying this as well. But if you really work with a good behaviorist, they will take into consideration all aspects of what's happening with the child. It is pretty important. Like, sometimes you won't even be able to give the child what they're asking for.
That's right.
And so then there are behavioral ways to deal with that as well. And these things become very important. Like, you know, sometimes the child is aggressing because the thing they want is to be taken out of the classroom. And, you know, what else are you going to do when they're disrupting the classroom? So these are the reasons that ABA in a lot of these types of situations has to be one-on-one. Mm-hmm. I mean, it is really important.
And it requires supervision by someone who's an expert clinician in treating problem behavior. And it doesn't have to be someone outside of the district. If the district has a great quality BCBA,
absolutely.
Great, you know.
Absolutely.
But if not, then it may need to be someone outside of
that's
the district.
That's right. And if the district doesn't have access to, let's say, behaviorists, but let's say you consult with someone. I just want to mention that our training corporation, our company, IBT, Institute for Behavioral Training, they have put together I think it's somewhere around 62 hours of training based on all ABA principles, and
that's
it's
right.
Very specifically intended for teachers and people in school settings, because you really do have very different contingencies when you have a classroom. And so we took all of the principles that we use, and I think you're even involved with
you were some of them,
yeah. So these are individual recordings that you can go online. If you go on the IBT website, which I'm not sure exactly, I think if you just Google Institute for Behavioral Training, I think we also have it all over our sites, but you will see these modules of training, which are all video based, and you can pick and choose and go to these interventions, and they'll go into much, much more detail about this particular concept and anything else that actually is problematic in the classroom.
And it's all based on stuff that's been proven to work by research. It's not just our opinion or our perspective or something. It's all evidence-based. It's all proven to work and
definitely.
Very detailed.
But again, just like a parent can't do an intensive program all by themselves, as a teacher, you can't address this type of thing without some form of assistance.
Absolutely. Yeah. All right, let's take a look at the next question here. Any suggestions on teaching counting out objects from a larger set? Working with my 8-year-old, he can count objects up to 50, but when asked to give me 2 items out of, say, 5, he'll just keep handing you the items and counting them. He's not getting it. So it sounds like maybe he's sort of counting by rote, but not really understanding quantities.
Right. Well, I mean, that is within our counting lessons that, again, I would recommend you go and look this up in our skills program. But within our counting lessons, there's so many different steps involved. And this is a little bit difficult to respond to, because I don't know exactly when you say your child is able to count up to 50, if he's counting rotely up to 50 or if he's counting objects up to 50.
Let's say he can count
objects up to 50.
So if you put 50 objects out, he can hand you them maybe and count up to 50, but
or not, just count them.
He just
maybe,
keeps
perhaps.
Going until they're all gone. Yeah.
Okay. Right. And that's very good. So, you know, there's a lot of different types of prompts, let's say, or things you can do to help your child stop when you ask for give me 2 objects. The very first, I mean, you'd want to start obviously with just give me 1, and then the remainder doesn't really matter. Actually, to make it easy, I would start with 2 objects on the table, and I would just tell the child give me 1, and if the child keeps giving hitting you, I'd stop them at that point and not consider that a correct response so that the child realizes they're giving you just one. If that's difficult for your child, another way you can do it is you can put the numbers by the objects. So let's say you have three objects on the table and you can put one and then two and then three on the objects, and then you can say give me one, and then the child would give you one, or you train the child to give you two, now they have to give you one and two. So you can teach this process, and then you can go all the way up to having 50 objects out, you know. So it's just a shaping procedure, and the whole thing is pretty detailed, listed step by step. And when you look at all the, I think there are at least 20 steps involved in counting from a set of objects. So you can do this. But let me ask you something to consider also, since you are giving us your attention. Why is it important for you to actually, I mean, you're going in this direction, your child is eight, and that's great, and it is important for the child to be able to count objects, obviously. But sometimes I ask myself, depending again on the level of the child, like, where is my focus? Sometimes we get so stuck on very specific things.
Academics, especially.
Or one narrow area, and, you know, make sure as you're focusing a lot of time on teaching your child to count and give specific objects, that your child's doing a lot more functional stuff as well, like maybe more aspects of social language, which would be probably more useful to the child going forward. And this becomes something that, of course, you have to decide.
Appropriate play skills, productive leisure skills.
Exactly. So
the kid has something to do in his spare time.
Yeah, and you know, another thing, as I make a recommendation to parents who write in here, and I ask them to, I often have to turn back and refer them to the skills program online. And, you know, so let me ask our audience a question as well, because our skills program is extremely comprehensive and it's very, very detailed. But often, and you know, it's a subscription per month and it's very low priced, but it's difficult for parents, I think, just because it's such a massive program, as I mentioned before, just the assessment section is very intense. And then when you go into the actual programs, it's even more intense. So I guess one of the questions, I've been trying to figure out ways to make the skills program much more parent-friendly and user-friendly. And for this family, for instance, you might not be interested in, you know, going in and delving into a whole new universe of skills that you have to teach your child, but you really just want to focus on this one area and you just want more detail within the area of counting objects. And if that's the case, it just makes me wonder if we should make skills available in subsegments. Mm-hmm. You know, what if this parent really just wants to have access to the counting program and mm-hmm. nothing else? Mm-hmm. So I actually would ask our viewers to write back in about that. So for those of you who are familiar with skills, your feedback is very valuable to us, because, you know, the whole reason we did skills was to be able to help families. And so if it's too many areas and too complex, would it be useful to you as parents, or if you were able to just access individual lessons, individual programs, and not necessarily have to subscribe to this, you know, huge universe of programs and so on? I'm always curious about that.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah.
All right, with that, we're going to move to a brief break, and don't go anywhere. We'll come right back with more questions for Dr. Doreen. Hi, and welcome back. I'm Dr. Jonathan Tarbox here at the Center for Autism and Related Disorders, sitting in for Shannon Penrod on Autism Live, and for our weekly Ask Dr. Doreen show. So welcome back. We have some more questions for Dr. Doreen.
Great.
Let's get right into it. So why is it that these kids seem to specialize in an area? My precious daughter, who is 11 years old with PDD, has a photographic memory.
Oh, I love that. Question. Yeah, I know. It's so amazing.
Nice to hear something positive, too.
Absolutely. I think to answer that correctly, I would have to say, first of all, we don't know. I mean, scientifically, we don't really know. But what it appears to be is that this is early brain development. And if there are some areas of the brain that are not developing as fast as others, other areas tend to develop much faster. There's a lot of actually research showing that there are specific areas within some of the kids where there's much, much more detailed dendrite growth. These are sort of the makeup, the composition of the nerve cells, neurons, and it's just the kids are much more developed in these areas. Visual, you know, like photographic memory is one of the categories of what we see with our kids. But then, I mean, some of our kids are just unbelievably brilliant in a number of different ways. Like, I was a few months ago, or earlier this year, I was out in South Africa, and one of our kids in South Africa, who was 9 years old, had already finished here in the States when he was in kindergarten here in the States. In kindergarten, he finished the 12th grade curriculum. So, you know, at 9 years old, there was pretty much, the family was having a hard time finding anything even online that he wouldn't be able to master on his own. I mean, he knew everything. It was unbelievable. And so what I usually say is, it's a blessing, it's great. If your child has photographic memory, there's a lot of research that shows that kids who are able to read, for instance, will develop language faster, hyperlexic kids. So, hey, use the visual aspects of your child's, this is a strength.
That's right.
And whatever you want to teach the child, actually show them as well visually, because they will retain that information. Having said that, also very important that when a child has really strong memory, one type of memory is extremely strong, they tend to just rely on that. That's how we all are, obviously. Mm-hmm. We rely on our own strengths without even being aware of it. So kids who are very strong on photographic memory tend to be very black and white, because they'll memorize something visually and they won't understand sort of alterations of that in real life. So, you know, it would also be very important to make sure that what your child is memorizing is perhaps helping them in terms of very concrete language development or concrete aspects of things they have to learn. But you also need to make sure the child isn't thinking that this visual version is the only thing.
Right, right.
You know, like one of the things we do is you'll draw a circle and ask the child, what is it? And a lot of times our kids who have strong visual memory will just say circle. And you'll tell them, give me other things. Like, what else could it be? It could be a pizza, it could be a cookie, it could be a multitude of other things. And just make sure that your child is also generalizing to other things and not really that strongly rule governed, because visual memory is really very much based on exact rules. It's exactly what you see.
Yeah.
So, but again, it's you know, it is a very positive thing, and you can use it.
So you use it as a strength.
As a strength.
Try not
definitely.
To play into the rigidity of it too.
Right.
Anyway,
yeah. Right.
All right. Let's have a look at the next question. As a parent, will I ever truly understand my child with autism? I research and I participate in their therapy, and I listen to them, yet I still don't grasp what they are going through. As a parent, this is painful to me.
Yeah. Oh, wow. That's an amazing question. And it is. And I often try to, I think for me, having been in this field for, 30 somewhat years, I've learned to, and having met so many different kids, you know, and the kids are so different from each other. Oh my gosh, like such a huge spectrum. But I think I've tried to bring together some commonalities within all the kids and try to understand their process. And the way that I see it, like the best example I give to parents is, I remember one time when I was in Hong Kong, and the flight to Hong Kong is unbelievably long from Los Angeles, and so I was really, really exhausted. And I had arrived there, and we were having a very hard time getting to the hotel. And so we were now on our 30th, 40th hour of being awake, had I don't know, 5-10 cups of coffee in order to just like stay focused. And then we're in downtown Hong Kong. Now, you can't really understand anything going on around you because there's nothing is in Latin script. Everything, you can't even read signs. You have to find someone who can understand English, otherwise the majority of the people don't want to be speaking English with you. So it's a different language completely. It's unbelievably loud in the middle of downtown Hong Kong. There's lights everywhere, you know, a lot more use of neon and this and that, and there's the toxicity level, I think, is pretty high. There's like buses and smoke and here and there and cars honking and just like massive amount of overload on the auditory, on the visual. And
even olfactory with the smell of the smoke.
Olfactory with the smell. And you're sleep deprived and you're just not really able to focus very well, or you can't function. And that's what I think the experience of our kids is. Oh, and it, in different levels, obviously.
Sure, yeah.
But I know that the majority of our kids have sensory overload. Which is part of the reason that they kind of like focus on one aspect that they can handle and they don't receive information from all modalities properly. And gosh, I mean, I always tell parents, how many kids do we have who don't sleep well? You
sure.
know, because they wake up multiple times, either it's a learned behavior or they have something waking them up, whatever it is. What about the kids who are sick, who have GI problems? Obviously, how do you feel when you have GI problems? You know,
right.
A lot of times when we get sick, we just stay home. Well, our kids...
Lousy nutrition. How do you feel if you don't
exactly.
have a junk food all day?
Exactly.
You know?
You're not getting anything that's useful or healthy for you. So, you know, it's a combination of... What your child's probably going through is a little bit of feeling lost and overwhelmed, I guess. Those would be the ways to express it. And what you would try to do, which will really help you not feel so bad about it, is to make sure your child is sleeping well, make sure that you identify the situations where your child gets overloaded. So a lot of times I won't put my child in school until I know that my child can handle those sounds and that environmental sort of chaos, and I will gradually make sure my child gets there. So I'm not saying avoid it forever, I'm just saying initially put your child in an environment or setting that's not overloading and make sure that you develop a form of communication with the child. Because when I was in Hong Kong, if I could even say a few words, I would find my way. I would find my way and I wouldn't want to just escape to my room and pull down the shades and just hide, you know? So that's what you're trying to do. You're entering the child's world in terms of reducing some of the environmental stimuli and then just trying to communicate with the child better. And once you're able to do that, then you gradually increase those environmental stimuli back to what is normal. And then you really go to, you know, the point where the child's functioning okay in a chaotic environment. But don't feel, you know, don't spend too much time. I worry about parents where we all worry about our kids and we feel like we don't understand them. You know, we're created in a way that we survive, and our kids, no matter what's going on with them, they occupy themselves, they reward themselves, they survive. So what you're trying to do is just change those contingencies and get them to receive all their reinforcers and rewards from us, from the normal environment, rather than from self-isolating and doing things on their own.
And, you know, one more thing I'd like to add that it's so easy to forget, especially for families living with autism and other disorders, is have fun, you know.
That's right.
It's so easy to get caught up with what's wrong with my child, what do I need to work on, you know, what treatments am I going to get him to, or what is he doing that he shouldn't be doing or isn't doing and everything else. Sometimes you got to just have some fun with your kid.
That's
pick
right.
something
that's
that he
right.
or she will love and that you'll enjoy and just do it and
that's
not
right.
worry, you know, just let
yeah,
things go.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, a lot of it just turned over time, especially when we're not getting help for our kids. I mean, once you start getting help, I think things change because you have a plan.
Yeah.
But once you, before that, I think all we do is we spend a lot of time fearing. Mm-hmm. You know, we're just like, oh no, this can't be, it won't be. But like, and it's almost like that phase is just so difficult to begin with that. That's where I worry about our parents, because they're just so concerned that things are getting worse and worse and so on. And hey, you know, let's be thankful. 20 years ago, we didn't have funding for behavioral intervention, right. And now we do. And it's so much easier to get that help, actually. Yep. Yeah.
All right. I think I have maybe about 30 seconds or another minute or two left for one, about 5 minutes left for one quick question here. And this is not a quick one, but... question is, why do we have to fight for treatments for our kids every step of the way?
I know, that's a crazy one. But it's funny that we just touched on that in the previous question. So, you know, years ago when I first started in California, there was really no funding.
Right.
And then I think the first thing we did, the first source of funding for families was to get regional centers, which is a more California type thing, and it's the Department of Developmental Services. And that was pretty minimal. It was like more for dealing with pretty urgent issues, or, you know, safety issues and those types, maybe parent training, those types of things. And then a lot of parents went to court over the years and actually got school district funding because of the Free and Appropriate Education Act. And so then we were able to also get some funding for working with the children in schools. And then now, of course, many, many states have insurance funding, thank God. So the majority of people are covered, not all, because a lot of employers still don't have autism benefits. But nevertheless, it's a whole different world than it was 20 years ago in terms of having to fight for funding. Now, let's say you have funding, then you have to find a good provider. That is difficult because although there are hundreds of behaviorists out there now, you really want to try to find someone who's following a program, a curriculum. They know where they're going. They know the future, you know, step by step, how to get your child there. And so, yeah, you end up having to fight for that as well. Let's say your child has medical issues. A lot of times with autism, all the medical stuff is overlooked because everybody's focused on the symptoms of autism. Well, you know, that's hard as well. I have parents coming and telling me, my child doesn't sleep at all, and I went to see the doctor, and the doctor said, oh, that's just part of autism.
Yeah.
And it's not part of autism. You have to fix those medical issues. You have to treat those issues in order for the child to be able to benefit from other interventions. So I know it's incredibly difficult, but every year, more and more parents sort of pave the way by making things happen. Everything that's happened in this field has been somehow connected to a parent.
That's right.
I mean, if you even look at all the recognition of autism through Autism Speaks, mm-hmm. they are parents, you
that's
know,
right.
who founded this that organization, or grandparents. And it really, whatever you can do, whatever you're learning from as a parent, then make sure you put it out there, because there will be more and more parents who will come and benefit from the steps you are taking now. And I know it's hard, it's crazy. When I do these conferences, I always say in my speeches, what other disorder do you know where you have to go to conferences to learn what to do?
Crazy, right?
Yeah. I mean, it's crazy. It's
crazy.
Just amazing. But hey, we have come a long way. We just have to keep going.